Does anyone have any comments or additions or deletions or editorials? I thought that they came out absolutely perfect.
I have a comment.
What? Yes, Mr. Edsel.
Madam Chair. My mic on? Number one, on page 3, at two-thirds of the way down the page, where it says be it ordered that, Mr. Edsel made a motion to table. And I think the phrase with the consent of the applicant should come at the end of that, just so it ties in with the reason it didn't go forward.
Good suggestion.
The only other comment, I guess, that I have, or question that I have, is to ask Judy Lardner if she's read through the findings of fact in the motion to deny, and those are as you remember them to be.
I had read through them. I think I was, I think the planner came up with the final rewording, and
okay.
I guess I was counting that she would have caught any errors. I'll skim them quickly, Steve.
Okay. I just thought in case that was important, we should make sure those are correct. Otherwise, that's all I have for comment.
I think it looks okay to me.
Okay. In which case, do we have a motion to accept the minutes as presented with that additional?
So moved.
Seconded?
Second.
All those in favor? Signify, raise your right hands. Opposed? Unanimous. We have items of correspondence this month. We had a letter from Environment and Development November newsletter, a letter from Robert Cram with respect to In by the Sea, a letter from the Code Enforcement Officer with respect to Highlands Subdivision, and an excerpt from the November 1992 Zoning Board Minute Meetings. Under new business tonight, the first item is the Gabriel Public Access Waiver, a request by Suzanne Gabriel for a public access waiver for lot R5-40 located on Wells Road, a public access waiver in accordance with section 19-2, 1942B. Is Ms. Gabriel here or someone representing her?
Yes.
To address him?
Yes, awesome. My name is Albert Frick.
Madam Chair, before we proceed, Sue Gabriel is an acquaintance of mine, and our daughters have played on different sports teams together. They always quite often seem to be on the same team. During the summer, it must have been softball season, we were chatting and she was asking me questions about the planning board and so forth, and then she mentioned that she's coming to the board. I said at that time, don't ask me any more questions. I can't talk about it if I'm going to proceed. I think the board members know that typically I'm very quick to recuse myself for bias or conflict. In this case, I don't feel that there's a bias. Matter of fact, we're acquaintances, but I didn't really know where the Gabriels' house was until I read through this, and then now I'm guessing where it is. I don't feel that I have a bias. I'd rather participate unless it's some other comment. If I feel myself getting in a position where some bias does arise, I think
I'd simply say something. I have no problem with it. Does anyone on the board?
No, I appreciate your coming forward, Mr. Edsel, but I have no difficulty with it. No.
Thank you.
Incidentally, Tom Emery will be late, if not here, not at all. And in which case, for this particular item, I would like to appoint Judy Lardner for to vote on this. Mr. Frick.
Yes.
Good evening. What are we up to here?
Well, this is John and Suzanne Gabriel are proposing to obtain a public access waiver to access a lot that they are creating with an existing house. The residents exist and they're proposing to delineate a lot around the house and take off another lot on the property. We've done a soil test, suitable soil test exists on the adjacent lot, have delineated the wetlands and the access to the adjoining lot and the public access road will not be impacting any wetlands in the area. We are asking for a waiver to not pave the first 50 feet of the access road. And we are asking for a waiver to have the traveled way to be 18 feet wide in lieu of 20 feet wide.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to ask a few questions to start off with. Usually I throw it open to the board, and I'm going to let go first this time. This is serving presently the building that's on that large lot right now. And they're proposing to carve off the lot with the building and then perhaps build themselves on the remainder.
That's
presuming
correct.
That's what's going to happen. So the road that is there now is existing as the access way to the building.
That's correct.
And is presently unpaved. Is there any particular reason that you configured the proposed smaller lot the way it is? This has nothing to do, I'm just curious.
Just try to please put that one up there.
Mrs. Gabriel, can you come up to the podium? This is being taped and it's also being broadcast, and they can't hear you from there.
To bring the driveway into another house on the larger remaining piece of land, mm-hmm. There was a well there, so the driveway, in order to avoid any wet area, had to come over a little farther. So that's just how we figured the lot out.
Okay, I just wondered why it had no frontage. That's as much as anything.
Well, with a lot around the house, if we sold the house, we'd sell it with either 2.5 acres or we'd sell it with 19 acres going from the back of this sort mm-hmm. of rectangle here over to here. If somebody was interested in buying a large piece of land, then that would be, it's not like developable land. It's wood, it's now under tree growth, so it's mm-hmm. part of a tree farm. So if someone were, it just looked like an easy way to do it. And then we'd have a house on the other, a smaller
other part.
House on the other part.
All
and
right.
Where it was 10 acres, that would be 10 acres. We just figured to keep the frontage with the lot that we'll keep.
Mm-hmm. The next question I had was, why the turnaround? Is that existing the way it is now in Chum?
Yes.
So you've been using the... I want to say Perez property, but it's
yes.
Nabok Land Association. And when you had it surveyed, you realized that you were actually encroaching on your neighbor and had this lease arrangement.
Mm-hmm.
So is it
before
possible?
Before he even owned the land, we always turned around there. It's just mm-hmm. sort of a natural break in the, I guess there used to be a road going through the stone wall at that point, so it was always
open. Yes, you
open.
Can see that. That's true. Could you easily set up another type of turnaround or access there?
I had
at the time it's terminated.
Yes, I had Mr. McGoldrick come over, and there are several different possibilities, like down in front, and he said if there was ever a problem with that lease arrangement, that there certainly would be adequate area to make another turnaround and going up the road in front of the house.
It appears that there would be. I didn't know if there were, you know, large trees that you'd have to chop down or a ledge or
No, in fact, I said, well, you can drive anywhere because we have trucks and tractors and so forth now that you can drive. And he said, but what if there's a snowstorm? It would have to be a plowed area.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all drive. It's very ledgy around there, so it's all pretty drivable anyway.
Okay. That's the end of my questions for now. Do we have other questions or comments from the board?
I have a question.
Mr. Edsel.
I always have a question.
You always usually talk after Janet, that's why.
Well, you went out of turn this evening.
I know, that's
evening,
true.
And you went first, so I got lost. Somewhere on here, I'm trying to figure out whether the road slopes up to Wells Road or slopes down away from Wells Road. I know it's 2% or less.
It's 0.02% sloping down towards Wells Road.
Sloping down. It does say 0.02%. Does that mean it's 0.2% or?
That's correct.
Or 2%?
0.2%, very level.
Just about as flat as you can get. The reason I ask that, of more concern in the last year or two, has been wash onto and I've been an advocate of trying to pave the first 50 feet because of that. You throw stone and so forth back out on the road with you, pulling in or pulling out. The stone washes out on the public road and it creates a safety issue with other traffic in that lane. I guess, unless it's concerns of others on the board, if it's flat as that states, we're certainly not going to get any wash, and there's evidently considerable drainage that in the first 30 feet there that it requires a culvert. Is that right? 8-inch diameter, that's not a real
correct.
Big culvert.
And that access, the first 50 feet, it's existing to be about 2 to 4 feet above existing grade. Mm-hmm. So there's not a lot of water washing across the existing access road.
Is test pit A within 100 feet of the existing dug well? Yeah.
Just about. That's 1 inch to 100.
Yeah.
It's very close. That was not dug for a disposal system. That was just dug to delineate the critical wetland.
Okay. Good. Were there five test pits dug for the proposed subsurface system?
Yes.
Okay. Are the results of those on here?
I believe we did submit those to Maureen. I do have a copy of the completed HHE 200 form.
Do you have five of them?
I'm not sure why you're doing this, Steve.
Just wondering if it's a buildable lot. Or is that a concern of ours?
I
get a nod here and a shake there.
Well, I don't know. I mean, they're coming for a public access waiver. And wouldn't that be the part of the code enforcement officer at the time?
He can certainly give approval, but the board has an interest in whether that's acceptable soils for a subsurface. There's no sewer there.
No, I know.
And there is a reason to know whether that's a buildable lot or not, to approve it as a lot.
All right, well, then proceed.
We have completed a subsurface wastewater disposal application. Have about five test pits in the proposed disposal area. And that was completed on January 9th, 1992. That was submitted earlier.
Okay. Do you have your profile, sir?
Yes, I do. The limiting factor was 2A, 32 inches to bedrock.
All right, fine. That's a typical depth of bedrock, 32?
That's correct.
That's good.
Or greater. We had test pits in the proposed area to 56 inches or greater.
Good.
That was the most limiting.
The concern is in a lot of Cape, we have less than 18 inches to bedrock. You get residents in front of that. More and more concern is the traffic of the effluent on the bedrock. Is the site distance to the east limited because of change in elevation, not by curve?
The distance to the left as you're coming out?
Yeah.
Yes. It's limited due to change in elevation.
Okay.
And curve. You both have the curve and a rise.
Okay. It's a little bit short, but and the line seems to stop right in the middle of the road, so I guess it goes from 100 feet to 106 or 107. So. I have no other questions.
Board, satisfied?
Mm-hmm.
I'm I think it's fine, proposed, I'm sorry, Maureen?
Tom Emery is going to be late to this meeting, but he did ask me to make some of his comments on this project. I believe his major concern was with the configuration of the proposed lot and that it didn't have any frontage at all, and that he didn't have any concern with adding another lot in this area that didn't have an adequate amount of frontage, but he was hoping that there would be a way to at least split the available frontage, perhaps by bringing the sideline straight down to the road. That would require both lots to have to get a public access waiver, but then he felt that it would put the whole piece of land in a much better development setup if you wanted to add more lots later on, because there's still enough room to run a road in the back. But he was concerned that this would be a bad precedent for creating a lot with no frontage at all. So I just wanted to add his comments.
Any other comments from him?
That was basically his concern.
I had similar feelings of why it was configured that way. I have no screaming objection to it being the way it is. There's a deeded right-of-way.
I'd like to hear from the applicant on that point. Could we have a response from the applicant on that point? Or you, Mr. Frick, I mean, whoever, but someone from the applicant to speak.
Mrs. Gabriel doesn't have a problem with extending that out to the road, if that was a reason, that she just didn't want to have to go for two public access waivers, and that was the reason for the delineation the way it was.
Mm-hmm. Just to assist the board with the procedure for this, it would be exact same procedure for getting the public access for both lots as it would be for just the one. There would be no additional fee. It's possible that could all be accomplished this evening.
Since they have a meets and bounds line running from that corner straight to the road, if that were an acceptable line, couldn't we approve based on that? And then if you had difficulties, you could always come back. Is that? I have no problems with this proposal.
Do you understand which line we're talking about?
Just extending this out, so this lot right out there.
I guess, I know, are you looking at an extension of the north 2 degrees, 20 minutes, 45 seconds east line, extended southerly, or the north 19 degrees, 07 minutes east?
Yes.
The
latter,
I think. That's what I was pointing to. I thought that would make
the latter.
The latter.
Yes. That's what we're, I just want to make sure we're talking about the same thing. That's what we're thinking.
So then the frontage, if that were the case, then the proposed smaller lot would have a frontage of just more than 152 feet on Wells Road, and the other lot would have a frontage of 132.
Right, about 170 feet, correct, the first lot. And
oh, I see. Okay, that's correct. That's correct.
10 feet to second.
Yeah.
And there wouldn't need to be any change in easement because there's always already a proposed easement for that segment. Mm-hmm.
Well, my feeling is that if it's agreeable with the applicant, I find that more palatable than the way it is right now, and I would go ahead with the double.
I only have one question. When I first drew this, I had it go straight out to the road,
uh-huh.
So that the lot, the existing house would have like 200 feet, and my other 10 acres was going to have 60 feet or whatever it was,
mm-hmm.
And then if we built a house and had too little access on the lot that we're going to keep,
mm-hmm.
And one of our children or something wanted to build a house out on the back of a 10 acres down the road, would that cancel out that if I didn't have enough frontage at this point? Does that, I mean, there can only be always one house lot on that 10 acres?
I don't believe so, no. Correct me if I'm wrong. As I understand it, you would have...
I don't have any, I mean, as
the same thing. If you were to put have it configured and approved this way, you'd still need another public access waiver for a rear lot. If you have it with the frontage on both, you're going to need another public access waiver for a rear lot.
Because it'd still be not enough. It would look better, I agree, if it had
some frontage.
Boat. Yeah.
Maureen?
But I guess I didn't want to, I mean, you never think things are going to change, but they do.
And so if and when, I just didn't want to cut off an option, I guess.
Maureen, can you have more to add on?
I think as long as you retain 50 feet of frontage on your lot, that leaves you open the option of coming in for future public access waivers, but it also leaves open the option of actually putting in a public road if you ever wanted to do that. So that's kind of the threshold.
No, that's fine with me. It would look, this really looks kind of an odd configuration.
It does.
Yeah. All right.
Ms. Gabriel, could you stay for just a minute? Let me ask the planner if I could, not to try to make this any more complicated than it needs to be, but if we were to extend, if the applicant were to extend the long sideline, which is north 02, 20, 45 degrees, 45 seconds east, to the intersection of Wells Road, there would actually be a smaller amount of frontage on the smaller lot and leaving a larger amount of frontage on the larger lot. Is that, would that ever be to the advantage of the applicant if she were interested in doing that?
At this point, because this lot is in the RA zone, unless you can achieve 200 feet of frontage, you have less frontage than you need to be a conforming lot. Mm-hmm. So you're then talking about, I don't really think the difference between 50 and 200 is that important. As long as you're continuing to use the same road, if you have up to 50, you always leave the option open of having a public road, and unless you have 200, you're still stuck in the public access waiver procedure. So it would give you a little bit more frontage, but you'd have to redraw the line, and that may cost you some funds as well. So that would really be up to the applicant.
Thank you.
So straight is better.
Is that she just said that actually it doesn't make that much difference.
Stay with her. Okay.
It's already on the plan. It's cheaper than to have it done again.
That's what we want.
All right, Maureen. In which case, then, actually, if they are I'd like to see this get off and out of here tonight, as I'm sure the rest of the board does. Speaking for myself, I will. I know, I've learned that. Miss Expeditious here. Is there anything in particular or that we should change as far as our reviewing this? Basically, we have, it would be one lot with frontage on a road being served by a driveway over, both lots would be served by the driveway. So then we would have, so all we have to do is just approve it or not approve it or whatever as two instead of one?
I believe all you would need to do is add a condition to your approval that would describe the extension of the addition of mm-hmm. that front corner piece that would give the new lot frontage.
And that's all. All right. That's it? Okay. Is there any further discussion? Let's
I have a motion to propose.
Why don't you? Very good. Why don't?
For the board to consider, the findings of fact would be that Suzanne Gabriel proposes to create a lot which does not have, actually proposes to create two lots. Then, which do not have sufficient frontage on an accepted town road, and each lot requires a public access waiver in accordance with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance before a building permit may be issued. Secondly, the applicant has proposed a turnaround with respect to the smaller lot, which is partially located on an abutter's property and is not legally part of the lot deed. Three, any discontinuance or relocation of the turnaround would violate the requirements of section 19-4-2B and must be reviewed by the planning board. Four, the application substantially complies with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Suzanne Gabriel for a public access waiver for two public access waivers of proposed lots located in the area of 77 Wells Road be granted subject to the following conditions. One, that any relocation or discontinuance of the proposed turnaround must be reviewed by the fire chief and the planning board prior to alteration of the turnaround. Two, that the longer, that the sideline of the smaller 2.6 acre, approximately 2.6 acre lot be revised to and extended to intersect with the existing Wells Road, and that revision be shown on the amended plan. And third, that this conditional approval and the improved plan shall be recorded as part of the deed to the proposed lot.
Second?
Second.
Any comment?
I'd be happy to have any suggestions in terms of language cleanup if anybody wants to take a shot.
I think if Maureen looks at what you said, and then as long as that describes the intent.
Thank you for your vote of confidence, Mr. Edsel.
Didn't say that.
I guess the only thing I would probably just said that the westerly line of the proposed lot be extended southerly in a course of south 19 degrees 07 minutes west to its intersection with Wells Road. So it's clear. That's all. But that's just me.
And the easterly boundary would have to also run, because I forgot about that one. Continue to run down to Wells Road as well.
Oh, that's right. But. And that the easterly boundary continue on the...
Of course.
Of course, it's on the other side.
The northern boundary of the proposed third line.
And if you keep going on this, I'm going to...
Okay, let's go.
We go back to the intent.
All right, yes. It's clear. All those in favor of the motion as read, signify, raise your right hands. Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. Next item under discussion tonight is a request by In by the Sea for site plan amendments. Request by In by the Sea Realty Trust for amendments to the previously approved site plan for the In by the Sea located on Bowery Beach Road. Tonight we're looking at site plan completion in accordance with section 19-2-10 of the subdivision ordinance. And who do we have from In by the Sea? We have, I should know all these names and faces by now, but I don't.
Good evening.
Steve.
My name is Stephen Moore.
That's right.
I'm from Moore and Sheridan. We're landscape architects in Portland. From the In by the Sea, we have Maureen McQuaid and Susan Legg, who
Thank
are
you.
Part of the management team. As we have outlined in our submission to you, the In by the Sea is requesting an amendment to their previously approved site plan. What I propose to do for the board this evening is just touch on the highlights of the plan.
Thank you.
And what we've submitted, and then let you deliberate on the issue of completeness. And then we can come back if there are in-depth technical questions or further more detailed presentation, we can do that. But in the interest of time, what I'd like to do is just touch very quickly. From the submission that you have in the Zoning Board of Appeals minutes, you know that we went back to the Zoning Board in November to get approval to modify the plan, which the Zoning Board had acted upon in November of 88. The inn was originally built in 1986, and it went through the approvals process in 1985 and 1986. At that time, the original inn and six cottages were approved with 62 parking spaces and 63 bedrooms. And were subsequently built with a subsurface disposal system, public water, and the parking, which is arrayed in the front and down the side. In 1986, and then in late 1986 and then early 1987, the adjacent piece of property was purchased and rezoned from residential to business B. And Mr. Clark continued to live in that house until recently, when the bank exercised its option and Mr. Clark moved out. And that's the reference that you saw in the correspondence from Mr. Cram in your earlier discussion this evening. What the inn is proposing at this point in time is to open the restaurant to the public. Right now it's a 48-seat restaurant, and the inn wants to open that to allow the general public to come in and use that. The use of that restaurant will be limited specifically to times and seats when it's not being used by the guests. The guests will have first priority on it, so that on evenings when the restaurant is full with in-house guests using it, if you were to call or stop in, you would not be able to get a table. So it'll be a guest priority restaurant. What is being proposed as a part of this site plan to support that public restaurant opening is the construction of a parking area on the site behind the existing cottages, leaving the Clark House in place and constructing an additional 44 parking spaces. 44 parking spaces has been selected for several reasons. First, we need 24 parking spaces to support the 48 seats in the public restaurant. Secondly, it's a configuration and a layout that seems to work well with respect to the existing area and what we have for available land use, leaving buffers and setbacks and green space. And thirdly, it allows us to get an additional 20 spaces beyond the 24 that are required strictly by the ordinance to allow for some of the additional staff that we brought in and some of the demand that goes on at the inn on a regular basis. So we're designing it for 44 additional spaces to bring us to a total of 106 spaces on the site. As I said earlier, the Clark House will remain, the Clark Driver will remain, and in our submission to you, we've indicated that that will remain as a residential use. After discussing the fire access with Chief McGuldrick, what's proposed is the construction of a gravel access on the side of the former Clark House. It'll be a 14-foot wide gravel access with a gated exit and entrance on both ends. So it'll be an emergency-only access. The inn will keep that plowed and knocked down from snow, but the gates and the barriers will be up. In the event of a fire, if the main entrance is blocked, they'll be able to duck in on that gravel lane, snap the chains, and gain access into the site. The other piece that's significant on this is the construction of another subsurface disposal system. In the earlier discussions with the state in 1988 and 89, the state had asked that we look at the kitchen waste as a separate waste stream, and so what we're proposing is to construct a separate system to serve only the kitchen. So the kitchen will have its own grease trap, set of tanks, and its old field, and that will require a little bit of replumbing on site, but that's what's proposed in this lawn area. Last point of note, just in terms of site improvements, what will be done is additional landscaping and buffering and transplanting of some of the existing trees. We're proposing to move some of the trees around to accommodate the emergency access, and then to reinstall fencing and do some additional low planting. We have met with the Rautenbergs and discussed the plantings at some detail with Rautenbergs, and the planting plan that's before you this evening reflects the Rautenbergs' wishes. I think that touches on most of the highlights of this proposal, and I think with that I'll turn it back to the board for your deliberations for completeness, unless there are some specific questions for me.
I have a couple of, again, just sort of general questions. The first is, boy, I've driven by there a million times. The Clark residence is that ranch, isn't it? It's White Ranch?
It's the low gray ranch with the two little birch bark reindeer out front. It's low gray,
I've white missed
trim.
It somewhere out.
How can you miss those reindeer?
I'll have to. That's right.
So there's a large maple in front, which blocks some of the view, and there are a line of pines or spruce over on the Rautenbergs property.
Okay, now behind the former Clark residence, where the driveway is, in fact, all that, is that, that's all open now, isn't it?
That's all open area, correct. This is an open field. Mr. Clark has his subsurface disposal field here, a vegetable patch here, and then that's currently open field.
What are you going to do with that residence? Do you have any plans for it? Are you going to tear it down or leave it there or what?
We're going to leave it, really for two reasons. First, we think it forms an ideal foil for the parking lot, helping to screen that and not open that up. Secondly, as we indicate in this mission, the inn does have a need for some interior storage. So part of that garage space and some of that interior space and interior closets will be used for inn storage. Plus, I think Maureen is planning to live there. Maureen McQuaid, the inn manager. So she'll be living there as a resident.
So it's intended now is really to become integrated as part of the inn property in a certain sense.
Yes, in that sense that Maureen will be living there. But
living there and that,
it's,
that you've got storage there, but you're certainly not going to abandon it or
no.
Let it become an eyesore. I was fascinated by the Vortec grease trapping, silt gathering, whatever you call that thing. I can't remember what it was, but it was...
That's something that Tom Adam, an engineer in...
Is that fairly new? It's
it
pretty
is.
State-of-the-art to me as far as separation of types of
it is. Tom had
sediment.
Started work on that back in 1987 as a part of another project, and then has refined that now to the point where he just got the patent on that, I think, this year in spring of 92.
Mm-hmm.
And it does do some interesting things. One of the issues that we had picked up in 88 and 89 was the one that Fred Morin mentions in his letter, which is it's much less of a quantity issue than it is a qualitative issue.
Sure.
And our feeling was that to invest the $10,000 or $12,000 to put that in and be able to get the water clean before it enters the tidal marsh was a good investment and something that was worth trying. I think there are two installations now in the state, two of these actually installed.
That's interesting, very interesting. Any other comments from the board? Judy Lardner?
Stephen, has the state approved the septic system now?
No, at this point we sent additional information to Department of Health Engineering November 22nd, and they are in the process of checking water consumption and looking at our proposal for the modification. So we're expecting approval this month. It is up at Health Engineering now.
Maureen, is there precedent either way for calling something like this complete pending a state permit?
You could do that. In some cases, I believe the board has required that certain items, usually a subdivision that has to get DEP approval, typically the board is required that final approval be here before you would continue with a review for, say, a final subdivision approval. In this case, you could also look at it in that all the information that is required to be submitted to the town for us to review the septic system has been submitted, and you may want to proceed with this and perhaps withhold approval until this you get some answer on this. Although once the board should be aware, once you deem this complete, there is some time issues you have to look at. Although being a site plan, there are no time constraints in the ordinance right now.
Okay. I think that's my only completeness question. I'll have others if we find it complete.
Any other comments from the board right now? Janet?
This really isn't a completeness issue, but let me just ask it while it's on my mind. Mr. Moore, what are the projected occupancy rates of the inn at this point? I'm not asking for what's happened in the past, but what are we thinking about in terms of guests as opposed to non-guest residents?
What the inn has been doing historically is that they are running 95% to 100% in the peak periods in the summer. And then in November, December, it starts to fall off so that they're running 60 to 80%. And what the restaurant is really attempting to do is to take some of that winter month and help take some of the curve, the cash flow curve, quite frankly, out of the operations deficit that it runs in the winter. So really what is envisioned is that in those summer months, in all probability, that restaurant will be busy, particularly in the very peak time, July and August. The restaurant would be harder to get a seat in, but when you moved into the fall or into the early spring, that would lessen. So that we really envision that peak use of that restaurant to the public being in the December, January, February, March period. Because that's typically when the occupancy, based on the historical records, is down at that 30 to 50%. And if I've misspoken, that's, we've tracked occupancy as a part of our permit with the state. We've run water consumption against occupancy rates, and that's part of the data that they had asked for to look at, because they're looking at what our actual water consumption is.
I suppose the only other question I had based on your earlier presentation was you indicated that the Rautenbergs, that the buffering on the property line, quote unquote, reflected the concerns of the Rautenbergs. Is it fair to say that the Rautenbergs have no objection to the buffering as presented on the plan? They're not asking for anything more.
That's correct. The reason I say reflected is we had a much thicker buffer. If you look at the previous plan, even the August 4th plan, this was almost a continuous buffer of taller evergreens. And they asked specifically for us to stagger some of the planting, break up the planting, and lower some of the planting. So the plant selections in here and here were actually discussed with them. So they've looked at this and we've discussed the plant heights and types. So it's a very accurate representation of what the Rautenbergs want to see.
Thank you.
Judy Lardner.
I'd just like to ask something since Janet brought it up. I was confused about that when I read the Board of Appeals approval. They said that visual screening shall be constructed between the inn and the Rautenberg's residence as required by the Planning Board to be maintained at not over 7 feet in height. But you have Austrian pines along their boundary too. I'm kind of curious how that works.
The specific plantings that the Zoning Board deliberated were these plantings here and here, which were previously the taller full evergreens. We reduced those down to the Mugo pines and the lilacs to reflect that 7 foot height. But the Rautenbergs still wanted some higher screening in a couple of areas just to break up their view into the inn buildings.
Maureen, could you clarify before we get to some point to make sure that the Board of Appeals intended that some be over 7 feet and some under? Because those Austrian pines clearly be over 7 feet.
I can check that. I don't know. I wasn't at the meeting, but I'll check on it.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Edsel.
I'm not sure that there's a point of completeness, but it's an issue that I've brought up previously at workshop that I think needs to be addressed at the beginning, and it may be a completeness issue. And that it deals with some off-site influence. Crescent Beach and the tidal marsh behind Crescent Beach is one of the nicest resources in Cape Elizabeth. And to date, I haven't seen any more current groundwater tests on that area done since 1988. I mentioned at workshop that I'd like to see an escrow account funded by the applicant to do a current study of groundwater testing for not to be limited to nitrates and bacteria. But I think it's our responsibility as a planning board to monitor the quality of that water. We have an enormous resource there, which we're adding more load to subsurface groundwater. Very much a nice state-of-the-art piece of equipment going into the runoff, but we're still adding a septic system to what's been described as very porous, very highly drainable, I'm not using the right term, but so as allow that water, and the way that I read the report from 1988 is that that does drain toward the tidal marsh. And I'd like to see an escrow and set up and a study done by a firm chosen by the town to study that. Just if nothing else, as a benchmark where we stand in 1993, I suppose that's when we'll be, versus 1988. As far as any other, I'm interested to see how long has the state had your application for the system for them?
Since early November. It went in November 7th, and then there was a request for additional information which came to us on November 19th or 20th.
Well,
it was mailed
quickly
out the 22nd.
Okay.
So it's been up there now since, I think, December 1st or 2nd it was logged in on the computers up at DHS.
Okay.
All right, why don't we first, if you have no...
One more question.
Steve, go ahead.
The Zoning Board of Appeals minutes in paragraph 6, the last sentence, it says the surrounding groundwater shall be tested in April and October of each year in accordance with the prior procedure set forth in the Stevens Report of 7588 and subject to the plumbing inspector's approval. What mechanism is in place to ensure that that's done each year, twice a year?
Our good faith. And not to be flip at all, but that's a condition we had agreed to, and we intend to comply with. There are piezometers. There are testing wells located down at the Toa Slope now. So the physical structure to do that testing is in place, and we intend to proceed with that. If the board needs the comfort of an escrow account, that's something we're willing to discuss in the process of reviewing the plan. But we mentioned this with Zoning Board, and we confirmed that with Zoning Board on the 22nd that we intend to perform those tests.
Okay, a question. I don't know how much it costs to do these tests. Do you have an idea?
The actual time to draw the sample out is not that much, but the testing, the full spectrum testing, is somewhere between $150 and $220 per sample. So each sampling shot, one from each of the two piezometers, is somewhere in the vicinity of $500 to $600 to do that each time. So we're looking at about $1,000 to $1,200 per year to do that sampling at 1992 prices.
Yeah, somehow it seems to me that there should be something in place to alert maybe the plumbing inspector every year on those particular months that those reports are due within 30 days or 60 days or something, so that he's aware of that. Is there any way of accomplishing that without relying on the applicant's good faith to do that in case, you know, in case the property sells or something like that?
Well, if the board wants, I'd be willing to look into it and talk to the building inspector and see if he has any suggestions, and also work with the applicant, see if there's something, some additional procedure we can work out beyond what we have right now.
I'd just like to add that I think it's the least we can do. I mean, this speaks to the ongoing testing of that groundwater, which I would suggest in some form be a condition that may be set forth. But as far as I'm concerned, number one, it's time that we know what the effect of the last 4 years have been on that water. Number two, just as one planning board member, if there's a problem, I certainly don't intend to increase the flow into that that area.
Steve,
and we won't know that until we have the testing done. I'm just advocating that be a firm hired by the town.
So you'd want something in addition to their biannual testing.
Right, as a starting place.
As a starting place,
right,
but not
yeah.
necessarily ongoing.
I think that what was said as a condition in the zoning board minutes should carry over into the planning board, perhaps as a condition of approval, that on an ongoing basis that it's a requirement. to report to the town. This improvement to their site, the applicant's site, is evidently going to have an impact on one of the town's nicest natural resources, and I think that that's a responsibility of the applicant to provide us with that information.
So I agree with you. I think that everyone, it's basically on point. It's just a matter of refining just exactly what we want and how we want to get there. And I think that it can be...
I guess I change it from a matter of not a completeness issue, but just as a forewarning that in your timing of this application, you might as well sit down with our planner and see how that might be worked out.
This will be an issue. So let's go on. All right, why don't we address the application completeness now, and we'll move on to what we're going to go from there. Also, I neglected, I was going to appoint Mark to vote on this. Mark, right? Peter. Mark. We should be voting on the completeness. Oh, all right, that's fine. Okay, thank you. Do we have any further discussion on that one particular point, which is the pending state approval? I, for one, don't. I just as soon go on with that. With it, I can accept it as it is. But if there's some discussion, let's do it now.
Part of the state approval, would that encompass this water being tested at the present time prior to them approving that system?
That has not come up in the discussions with Jay Hardcastle as far as doing additional sampling at this time.
I mean, it seems to me we need a benchmark to go from, and now seems to be the time when we have the opportunity where, if we deem you complete tonight, you're coming back again next month for a public hearing, and how long would it take for those tests to be complete and the results gotten back to Marine for dispersal?
It takes approximately a week to 10 days to actually have the samples tested by a testing lab. To draw them is a matter of a couple days. The only question I would have is one of what the holidays do as far as the sampling goes. But I think it is possible to have that information back in time for staff to review prior to the next meeting.
Okay. As one board member, I would suggest that be done. But I'll leave it up to everyone else.
Well, why don't we get, let's do application completeness first, and we can go on from there. We can bring that up into some further discussion.
Madam Chair, just one more question of completeness.
Yes.
Under signage, it says not applicable. Just want to confirm with the applicant that there's to be no change in the sign dealing with a new restaurant and so forth. Just trying to get all of the issues so you have it all before us.
We're not entirely sure what's going to happen with the sign. That's something we're still looking at.
Okay.
Do I have a motion from the board? Janet?
Seems to be my night for motions.
Yep.
I'd like the board to consider this motion. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of N by the Sea Realty Trust for amendments to a previously approved site plan located at N by the Sea on Bowery Beach Road be deemed complete. Be it further ordered that a public hearing be scheduled for the regular January 19, 1993 meeting of the Planning Board.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hands. All those opposed? Mark, are you abstaining?
Voting on completeness and...
Yes. Indeed, you better. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, okay. It's unanimous. Good, thank you. All right, do we want to go on to have some further discussion, or I think perhaps the first thing we need to make clear is our feelings about the groundwater testing, so that those are in place.
I guess I would have one question back to the board.
Mm-hmm.
There was discussion that the town hire an independent firm. Is that what you're requesting to have done for
right.
this for this water testing that you want submitted now?
Yes, for the starting. As far as it does not have to be an independent contractor on an ongoing basis. I'm just saying as a starting point, I'm looking for an advocate for the town to do the testing. You're looking at me with quizzical eyes, but I know that that's not a standard operating procedure.
No, not at all. I don't think bringing a third party in is a problem, but as far as, are you looking for interpretation or just simply drawing the samples out as a fairly routine matter?
I'm looking for the interpretation by an independent firm hired by the town.
Maureen, do you want to step in? Thank you.
Well, first of all, I guess the hired by the town made me a little nervous. But typically what happens is that we would do something like this, and the applicant would set up an escrow account, and we would pay whoever we hire through that. I was going to ask Mr. Etzel if he would be willing to rephrase that to say that a firm that is approved by the town, that we would let Mr. Moore make the arrangements, and we would approve who.
Why wouldn't the town want to hire the?
Makes the billing procedure a lot clearer.
How so?
Well, the bills are going directly to the applicant rather than to the town.
But we hold the escrow account, and we simply pay out of the escrow.
If that's what the board wants to do, certainly that can be set up.
I'd just like to ask, why is this different from other consultants who delineate wetlands or do other kinds of soil testing? I remember raising an issue once. I think it had to do with surveying of a 19.99-acre subdivision, and I thought the idea was that if you have a reputable firm doing this, that we basically have to trust whoever does this. I have no reason to distrust this applicant or the professionals they've hired. Is there something I'm missing?
Maybe not, but I don't necessarily trust the professional firms. I'm just very very upfront saying that I think that we should have a firm hired by the town. It's in our best interest, not in the best interest of the applicant, is what we're looking for. I don't want to take the chance on the size of the natural resource that we have at Crescent Beach and the tidal marsh behind there to listen to an advocate of the applicant.
Janet McKay.
Madam Chair, I don't know what I think about this. I guess I would just like to say that I would like for us to consider Mr. Edsel's comments further, and we'll have some time to think about it between now and the next meeting. I guess it troubles me to some extent to deviate from what we have done in the past as a procedural matter, unless there is some overwhelming reason to deviate from it in this case, and perhaps there is in view of the the particularity of the resource that we're trying to protect, but that's my comment.
Maureen?
I just want to clarify, I didn't want to imply that we've always done it one way. We've had the board and the town has a history of actually going either way. So
but I would hope that we would do the we would err on the side of doing it in the most simple and straightforward way, unless we had some reason to take the more complicated and the more frankly expensive route.
Judy Lardner.
Our town engineer or that staff does have the capability to analyze a water analysis, and are we questioning whether we're going to get incorrect readings or not be able to interpret that?
I think it's a matter of professional interpretation of the readings.
I guess I feel almost like Judy did. I understand where you're coming from, Steve, and I certainly can be might well be swayed in it, but gosh, when a professional engineer who's got a seal and it's untenable for him to make, he has this information, he has to tell you what it means. His license depends on it.
I just refer to, I think, the Highlands application, where I think there were three different professional firms that did the wetlands delineation and a wetlands interpretation, and then they were all three different. And they were all had different advocates, the neighborhood and the town, I think it's Normando, and the applicant. And they all varied. I don't see there's anything wrong with having a varied source of information. And I think in this case, since the resource that this site influences is of major importance to this town, that we have a real strong interest in protecting that.
If I might make a suggestion to the
yes.
board, we are more than willing to retain CV and Mahar and draw the samples ourselves and submit both the sample results from McFarland testing and CV and Mahar's analysis to you. And pending what those results show, we will escrow money and the town can retain a firm to evaluate whether or not CV Mahar's procedures were correct and whether the test results were correctly interpreted. Mm-hmm. We'll submit that. If the evidence is as what we suspect, which is the water tests will show no nitrates, phosphates, or other contaminants, then there may not be a need for an additional interpretation. But we'll leave that up to the board and the town to make that decision. But we would rely on CV and Mahar to follow up on the testing, and then, as required, we will escrow to cover a third-party review of that information if you so desire.
I'm not sure that we need to, pending their I would simply like to have the interpretation of an independent firm.
I think what he's saying is if it comes up negative, 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 do we need somebody else to tell us it's negative? Vis-a-vis, if we mm-hmm. have real readings, in which case you can balance them.
It's been my experience over the last 3 or 4 years that all the way from groundwater testing to Tier 2 and Tier 3 site assessments, environmental site assessments, that you can have an incredibly wide range of opinion from every firm. I'm looking at the interests of the town, that's all.
No, I know you are. I'm just going off on that one point. Why don't we have any other input from the board on this? All right. Now we have a site, we have a public hearing scheduled for our next meeting. Do we have anything else we want to discuss with the applicant before we can, yes you did, go ahead, Mark.
Yes, I have one question that I, was wondering about in terms of the site testing. Some of our background analysis indicated that there was a stormwater management study done in 1988 by land use consultants in addition to the CV and Mahar study. Would that have phosphate information in it that could be compared at this point in time?
There is, I think in your package in the CV Mahar report are the samples, both surface samples from stormwater and groundwater samples. They were not contained in the land use consultant's report. That was strictly a stormwater management. But as a part of the submission in 1988, CV Mahar looked at not only the groundwater information from the piezometer wells, but also they looked at they sampled within the catch basins on the site, and they sampled at the drainage outfall to look for contaminants coming from surface runoff or possible subsurface contamination leaching from the system into the adjacent stormwater system. And I would have to go back and actually refresh my memory on which samples. The McFarland testing results are in your submission. I'd have to go back and refresh my memory which of those actually fell within that testing.
Yeah, they all address fecal coliform, strep, and nitrate
yes.
only. But if there was other analysis done at that time for phosphates or other contaminants, that would be, I assume, of interest to the board.
Certainly.
Do we have any additional discussion?
Is there any reason we would do a site walk on this?
That was my next point. I think that we should. If no other reason than it's fun to get out and look at it. The applicant, I presume, has no objection to that?
None whatsoever.
None, okay. Do we want to schedule a day for that, Saturday morning? Let's see, our next meeting is going to be, when was it, January 19th. I'm pretty full from now to the first of the year, but speaking only for myself. I mean, do something first or second week in January?
Is this an indoor sidewalk?
It's an outdoor sidewalk.
We'll make it July.
Maybe we'll be invited in for coffee and donuts.
Well, can't expect.
What? Only if we're a guest or pay us.
I'd suggest that the Saturday, the 2nd of January, not the...
No, that's not another good one either.
The 9th of the 16th.
I need a new book.
They can't write
the 9th? That's as far as my book goes, so it better be the 9th. Saturday the 9th, is that all right? Agreeable with everyone? January? Steve?
My calendar only goes to the 3rd.
Sorry.
We'll have to rewrite it down on a slip of paper and pin it to your jacket.
I'll be out of town that weekend, but I'll be out of town the next one too.
And the next week too, so nothing's going to get better for you. All right, why don't we make it the 9th? What time? 9:30? That's okay with me. Is it all right with everyone else?
Where do we meet?
How about the parking lot? Or the lobby?
In the lobby.
Okay. 9:30, lobby. By the sea. Okay. Any more discussion? In which case, if none, we have a motion? We do?
We have a motion for complete. We don't have the article before, so.
And that's all? You don't have to table or anything? No? Oh, okay. I guess that's it then.
Do we need a motion for the public hearing on the 19th?
No, it's already been made. It was part of the completion.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Madam Chair, as in the past, the I have to excuse myself from the Highland subdivision amendments issue. And due to a possible conflict, I have to excuse myself from the Meadowview subdivision amendments.
You want to go home now?
I know. No.
No, thank you, Steve. The next order of business tonight is the Highland subdivision amendments, a request by Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the previously approved Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road, in accordance with Subdivision Ordinance Section 16-2-5. Mr. Parkhurst has excused himself. I will appoint both Mark and Judy Lardner to be, have this worst time on your last name. I keep tucking it up. Wilcox. Oh. To be voting members of this item. We have Mr. Kennedy. Would you like to come up and explain why we're here? What's going on, please?
Peter Kennedy, Greater Portland Development Group. It became apparent when we were starting the initial construction of the emergency access road that the road was designed 10 feet to the south of where the DEP envisioned it and I envisioned it. So we basically ceased construction and went to the DEP to confirm that in fact our plans were different from their plans, and hence the reason in a nutshell to be here to approve the new emergency access road to be moved in approximately 10 feet to the north.
Could you explain on this plan where it is in, do you have any, can you put it up for the
Sure.
viewing audience to see what the...
That or not.
Okay.
This is the new location. The existing approved location was 10 feet too close to this pond, and in fact, the fill extension of the side slope of the road was on the shore of the pond. And that's not what was initially envisioned during the approval process. And so the road had to be, had its horizontal alignment moved approximately 10 feet to the north.
How did the DEP had a different set of plans? Or
the DEP approved the project in December of 1990. Subsequently, we came back before the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board to get final approval, and some changes were made. Not necessarily with the road alignment, but with the fill extension of that road. There was more gravel added to it, and it was a real road, whereas the DEP envisioned a reconstruction of the existing road. That wasn't to be the case, because it wouldn't, in the town's opinion, hold up emergency vehicles, fire trucks, ambulances, etc. So the road was the DEP was not aware of all the changes that were made by the planning board in their approval process. We maintain that, in fact, they did have the drawings, but to date they haven't found them, so that's why we're here, to get the road redesigned in a 10-foot northerly direction, kicking the roadway away from this pond.
Does that change the lot lines?
No.
What are the shaded areas over here? No, it's shaded. Is that the limit of development now?
This is the match line to match the next sheet. The limit of the development on the first phase is in this area, station 7 plus 9 0, I think.
So this heavy shaded area is the limit of present construction? Do you understand?
You're looking at a paved section
paved?
Here, and I don't know what the shading to the north of that is. Maybe it is to indicate limit of construction.
So this is basically what you're here for, is just the change of the road?
Alignment.
Alignment.
Yes.
The horizontal alignment about 10 feet northerly of its previously approved location.
That is correct.
Okay. We have, while we're here, Mary, maybe Maureen, you can help us on this. We have a letter to Peter Kennedy from Ernest McVeigh, dated November 12th.
November 12th?
Yes. With respect to erosion control measures, construction monitor, site work being commenced prior to posting of bonds, and the assessment of a fine. What's the status of that?
Mr. McGovern and I have been discussing that issue, and we also discussed it again at 4:30 today.
And I'd like to hear some more about the status of that, Mr. Kennedy. What's the status at this point, besides that you talked about it?
He and I have discussed the fine, and I don't necessarily agree with the findings. So that has been the extent of the discussion.
I don't presume to speak for the board, but I certainly do presume to speak for myself, and I think this letter is very, very, very disturbing to me, and it's part of the background of what you're here for today, as far as I can understand it. And this letter says that based on the surveying stakes that which you provided, that wetland alterations have exceeded the wetland special permit limitations, that the road placement is not in accordance with the approved subdivision plans, that erosion control measures critical to protection of abutting wetlands during the construction phase were not installed in a timely manner, that a construction monitor was not on the site, and that site work was commenced prior to posting a full performance guarantee as required by the ordinance. Plus, it goes on to page 2 saying that you began work without a performance guarantee, you began work without a recording plat for 56 days. You know, to me, this demonstrates, or at least indicates, an incredible not paying attention to what it is that is required of you, and I take that into full consideration when I'm trying to think about addressing whatever else it is you're asking us to do. I really would like to have an explanation for why it is that this this stuff occurred.
Would you like me to go down point by point?
I'd appreciate it.
Okay. The erosion control in a timely matter, I disagree. I'd like to know when it was not in place and where it was not in place.
I'm relying on the code enforcement officer, but I'm saying that I need to rely on him because he is part of the town
my
management.
My answer to that is I disagree with the finding.
Okay, next point.
The construction monitor, his diary is available and he was there.
How about starting with the first point, that wetland alterations have exceeded the wetland special permit limitations? Is that in dispute as well?
Yes.
Is anything not in dispute, Mr. Kennedy?
The degree of, we did prune some wetlands vegetation at the initial start of that road where the pavement ends, but we did not do any grubbing. And that was on the existing old road that went we'll call it the prior fire access road.
Well, I don't intend and don't pretend to get into the details of the thing, but I guess what I'm curious about is it's your position that you have done everything that you were supposed to do in accordance with the plan and that the code enforcement officer is all wet? Is that basically
what
it is?
No, that is not true.
Okay.
However, the plan has approved was not the way the DEP envisioned it. And I discovered that. That's when I ceased. So the indication from the code enforcement officer was that I was building a road in a non-improved location. That is not correct. We were not building the road. We did not bring in any gravel, and we did not put in any utilities.
And then is it your position that as soon as you discovered this discrepancy between the plan as approved by the town and the plan as approved by the DEP that you stopped all construction work and went to the DEP and said, what did you mean by this?
No, not what do you mean by this. We said, let me see your plans that you're going by, and I compared it to my plans. They're different.
And the plans that the DEP had were plans that were submitted by you?
Squaw Bay Engineers, that's correct.
Your agents?
Yes, my engineer.
I don't know where to go except that I'm very disturbed to see you back here again, particularly with these kinds of things at issue.
I can't agree more.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Edsel.
I'm just as frustrated. The plan is very difficult to read. I don't keep all old plans. We tend to turn them in or destroy them. The plan as they're drawn here doesn't show me where the mistaken location of the road is. It does show the existing edge of the existing gravel road, but it's not clearly readable as to what the change is that needs to be made compared to what the actual improvements to the site are. In other words, existing mistake, here's the amendment to change what we want to do. That's what, it's quite simple, I would think, to be able to represent that. This is, I don't know what number of time you or one of your representatives have been here in a similar situation. The last time I remember, Mr. Moore was here to represent you. It was a case of, erosion control screening not being in place and seeding. And I personally visited the site, and the screening wasn't in place. I got out of my car, and unless it had just been seeded, it wasn't noticeably seeded. And then on that night, we were told everything was okay. Those types of things are frustrating, aggravating, difficult to deal with. I would just suggest there are three items that, according to our court enforcement officer, to be completed. And Maureen, correct me if I'm going astray here. That I think we can have A and B, C completed and then come back to the board for approving an amendment to the plan to reflect the relocation, if you can. Where are you in the step of wetlands restoration plan right now?
Steve Moore will be preparing a wetlands restoration plan for Mr. McVain. We have met with the soils and conservation people with DEP and have done what they've requested. If the town requires more, we will do that.
Okay. This is just a suggestion, board, but I'd like to see A, completed, that a wetland restoration plan be submitted by a design professional reviewed by the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District, and that plan be submitted to the planning board. Then the issues of the payment of penalty. You need to resolve that with Mr. McGovern in the town of Cape Elizabeth. Mm-hmm. When that issue is resolved, I think that's the time to come back to the planning board.
We'll
handle item B.
It's fine.
I would say that as far as I'm concerned, I agree with Steve. Number one, the completion of that, and I would want a letter from Mr. McGovern or Mr. McVain, probably Mr. McGovern both, explaining to us that you have reached a resolution and they're satisfied with the results regarding the $8,000 fine. And I don't think you belong here tonight until those things are taken care of. Further, we have, and I'm not really quite sure, I'm sorry, did we have, Judy, did you have something to say further?
Can you follow into your comments?
Okay. Janet, you're satisfied? So one of the things we have correspondence, a request by the folks at Broad Cove, some of them, to have a public hearing. I don't even think we're at a point where this is even germane. I think once you've got the rest of the things squared away that need to be before any one of us even here wants to listen to it, at which point you can guarantee that there will be a public hearing at one point, probably the second meeting after you bring this before us, because there's some input to be heard. In which case, I have nothing further to say.
I just have a question to the applicant. Do you think that those issues can be resolved by the submission date for the January 93 meeting?
Yes, I'd hope they'd be resolved by today, but unfortunately I was unable to do it.
Okay. Do we have a motion from the board?
I just have a couple of comments.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Before you come back, Mr. Kennedy, I hope you clean up these plans tremendously. We have 4 pages of comments from the town engineer of things that need to be remedied. I think it should be absolutely clear when we look at this what was approved by the board and if there's discrepancies with DEP. I'm not sure you don't need to go back there and get your approval with them revised, but what have you, I think we need to see what was approved, what you've done out there and what you're asking to do out there. I'm confused. You say you want to move the road north, but you've infringed, I think, on the wetlands to the south. I don't know how this has happened. I'm very disturbed that you are seeming to say the DEP has other plans, and they're confused. Those are your plans, and those are your consultants, and you better take charge of this project. because you're the one that comes before us, and if it's not a little more under control, I'm not going to do anything for you or on these plans until it is. Because if I can't count on you to be in charge of this project, I don't think it should go forward. And I'm sorry to be harsh, but I am very disturbed to hear you kind of disclaim responsibility for this.
No, I did not disclaim responsibility,
well,
but...
Well, how about a disagreement that there have not been some erosion control measures violated when... This is not the first letter we've got on this. I've seen stuff from code enforcement, I've seen things from the DEP, and I've seen something from Water and Soil Conservation repeatedly talking about violations, how you had to remedy that, and have you say that you disagree with this, I am flabbergasted. So I hope that you can resolve this and come to before us showing us what you're proposing and say if there's mistakes been made or what, but take responsibility for this, please. Thank you, Judy. Jen?
I have a motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road, be tabled to the regular January 1993 meeting of the Planning Board.
I'll second that.
Is there any discussion? I'm going to add one more thing, which is... harks back to the DEP. I would also like to see something saying that the DEP approves these plans as you are submitting them to us now, and that what they have up there isn't something different, and that your DEP approval for this project isn't for something different from what we're approving.
Well, I intend not to make that mistake again. I'd rather get your approval than go to the DEP so that we don't go this back and forth.
As far as I can see right now, you've got an unapproved DEP project. And that's unbuildable, it's unmarketable, it's on anything. And I know we don't have the jurisdiction of the DEP, but I for sure on this don't want to have them with one set of plans in Augusta and us with another set of plans down here. And we're talking about apples and oranges, and you're building bananas. Okay? All those in favor of the motion as read, raise your right hands. Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next order of business tonight is Meadowview subdivision amendments, a request by LE Construction for amendments to the conditions on the Meadowview subdivision, a 6-lot subdivision located off Mitchell Road in accordance with subdivision ordinance section 16-2-5. Tonight I would like to, for this particular project, appoint Mark Wilcox to be our voting member. And let's see, we have before us, I believe, Mr. Lydon.
Yes. Yeah.
Would you please announce your whole name and...
Larry Lydon.
I do? Oh, that's right. I'm sorry. And Judy, that's... And Judy Lardner is also appointed there.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'm here tonight to ask for a planning board for an amendment to the Meadowview subdivision. The amendment before being a performance bond that was never put in place at the time of subdivision approval. We just handed you some additional information. Coming into this, I guess we really didn't know what was expected of us. So now we've added some additional information. I guess the whole issue is the bond itself, okay, as far as the, what we're asking for. And I'm not really good at this. Looking at the information I've just provided you with, I think that we've answered all the questions raised by Mr. Fred Moore in the town engineer and the review he did.
Mm-hmm.
The second commitment letter you'll see here, we didn't really know what we were looking for, you know, as far as our price goes. I was under the impression that the town engineer would set the amount of the bond. I was not, you know, being my own fault, I was not aware that we'd have to come in with a detailed construction cost, and the bond would be set from there. The second commitment letter we have from the bank, the $107,000, that number there we arrived at what the board originally asked for. Okay. Since then, we've got our own construction breakdown, and you'll see that from MJ Cowan, we have a breakdown on the road cost of $104,000, Owen Haskell, $4,500, Richard Manthorn, $1,000, and myself, $500 for the pedestrian bridges. From there, we come up with $110,785, adding on the 10% contingency cost, $11,078. We come up with $121,863. Am I making sense to anybody? Okay. So I assume this is what you're looking for, a detailed breakdown, coming up with a cost, a budget, and from there arriving at the what you're looking for a bond. Okay. We didn't really realize all this information until we got the review. Since that time, we put all this together. We are capable of getting the letter of credit for the $121,000.
But you don't have anything from Mr. Christensen saying that?
No, but we demonstrated originally $100,000, $107,000. I think we've demonstrated that we can get the letter. Just a little background information myself. 3 years ago, I did Mantle Road subdivision, a 15-lot subdivision on Mitchell Road.
I'm sorry, which one?
Mantle Road. I think the project was pretty successful. It was a well-done project. We had no problems. In conjunction, we did some work with the town on some abutting roads. Campion Road, we updated the storm drain and sewer in that road.
Okay, but you haven't to date submitted one of the things is the form of letter of credit.
Right. We haven't actually bought the land yet. And there again, we didn't know what price we were looking for. We are, I guess I was saying if that's an agreeable price, we will submit that immediately.
Well, to me, the figures seem right. We will need the form to be reviewed by our town attorney.
Right.
In which case...
I guess what I'm asking for is an approval conditional upon these items?
Uh-uh.
No?
No.
Okay. All right.
No.
Okay. I guess they asked then, is there any other issues?
Okay. I'm just going through some of the things that had come up. The easements, we have the town attorney has reviewed the easements and he's approved them.
Okay.
The deeds. The performance bond really appears to be the only item. Are you doing anything to change the subdivision?
Nothing.
This was the first project I sat on when I came to the planning board. It was, I know, it was the very first, I remember.
Mine too.
I voted to deny it too. Judy Wagner?
The town engineer, besides dealing with the performance guarantee issues, does talk about the proposed pedestrian bridges and additional details he would want, some DEP standards that were provided to the applicant. I assume that was you.
I think everything we submitted was acceptable.
Oh, okay, but I would like to see those things addressed. Otherwise, it seems to me straightforward, and as long as you came back before us next time with something from our town engineer saying these figures look correct and you have the right form, it looks straightforward. But I would want you to make sure that you've got the bridge details worked out with him.
Okay. I think all he was asking for was he wanted to see the bridge details included in the cost.
He did, and then he wanted to see where the foundations would be and
okay.
so forth.
I think I answered that also. We're just going to set them on sleepers. I'm not looking. I was told to be low profile, and I mean, these are in the woods. I mean, I don't see us, you know, lugging in concrete and making foundation, you know, piers for these bridges.
I would just want to make sure our town engineer agrees with your approach.
Okay.
So work that out with him. And he also comments on an updated traffic, that no updated traffic that has been provided. I'm not looking for that personally.
No,
I don't know if
I agree.
Other board members are, but since they're not increasing the intensity of this development.
Mr. Wyden, do you understand now how we operate
yes.
a little more? Because I think you're really very
I'm
close
sure
to it, but it's too
yeah.
bad that I don't think we are in any position to do anything tonight.
Okay.
What we would need to do is to have you submit, hopefully on one sheet of paper or two sheets of paper, just the whole breakdown of the 121,000 and change
okay.
that you think is including
yeah.
the, you know, the 10%
yeah.
overage. And then that information that you submit gets in a package and goes to the town engineer comments,
right.
and if the town engineer comes back and says, gee whiz, the applicant has met all of my concerns that were expressed in my letter of December the 7th, the bridges
yep.
are fine, the,
okay.
you know, whatever is fine, and
yep.
you give us the form of the letter of credit, it doesn't have to be filled out. It doesn't have to be signed by the bank, in other words, but there
yeah.
is a, do we have a standard form of letter of credit, Maureen? Or?
Yes, we do, and I did give the applicant at least one copy of it.
Ah, okay. So if you've done your part, the town engineer says you've done your part,
yeah.
we come forward with this, these pieces of paper. It's, I mean, I don't mean to denigrate them as pieces of paper, but I think once you get that part done, it will be a very
simple,
straightforward
yeah.
Operation
okay.
next month.
This is Paul Bose. He's working with me and the bank in this deal. He just wanted me, in the file we noticed that there was a letter of credit originally drafted by the same bank. Would that was acceptable back then? Would it still be acceptable today?
I wouldn't try it, no.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Times have changed.
Okay.
We all know that.
Thinking like that?
Madam Chair.
Mr. Edsel.
Yeah.
I just looked from Maine Earth Moving, the proposal in May, to the December 15th. And the December 15th, I haven't had a chance what you handed out to tally all these numbers up, but their previous proposal included paving, and for the life of me, I don't see paving in the December. And that's a 15-8 item, $15,800 item.
Hmm.
And I don't see it in the second proposal. I don't see it elsewhere in here.
Okay.
I mention that because it also was my first subdivision, and I remember one of the key issues on this is that there's the groundwater drainage of the site is said to sheet over the entire front two lots and three lots, and that the curbing is extremely important. I just bring that up because if you are not aware of at that time. That it was approved, that was a real big issue. And Dick Tinsman, who was on the board at the time, really never felt very comfortable because the water does sheet down off from Mitchell Road, comes into that site, and really uses that Cape Cod berm curbing, which is required on the entire length and not to be broken on the entire length of that road,
okay.
as a drainage system.
Okay.
to move all the water off from that site, and it's extremely important that you know that, if you didn't know that before, and number two, it drew my attention to the paving here.
You know, I apologize for the, you know, this stuff coming in so late, and like that. I would, just for main earthwork, I'm sure they just missed it on the quote, and we will correct that, okay, before we submit it to the town.
Another question, I should say. The prior applicant was intending to move the house, I think, shifted, excuse the microphone, move the house over to, I can't remember what lot number it is.
Two.
Is that still your intent, or to demolish the house?
I would say we're leaning towards demolishing the house.
Okay.
The house is on a slab, which makes it kind of hard to pick up. It's too much work construction, electric heat. I would say we're going to demolish it, but I'm not sure of that.
The property's been vacant for a while, hasn't it?
Yep.
Could you just, and I'm not saying that as one board member, I'm going to hold this as an item on the cost, but there's certainly some legitimacy to the fact that the intent of this whole issue is get into this project and just stop. Somebody's got to complete the project, and if you get X number of feet down the road, end the road, and we still have a house sitting in front of where the road's supposed to, somebody's got to move the house or demolish the house. Can you just come up with a figure for demolition of the house? I would estimate.
Fire department has contacted us already. They'd like to
burn
it down.
Great. For just a letter from the fire chief.
Okay.
Saying that's what they want to do.
Can I bring, I live just down the street, can I bring some brush down? Let me know what you know.
Could be marshmallows and a stick, right?
That's it for my question.
I have nothing. Everything has been said. I think that you're pretty much on target for what we're looking at.
Why doesn't the planner let us know what the due date is for submission in January?
That would be January 4th.
Okay. Which is that Monday right after the first of the year.
Right.
Actually,
18 days falls on January 1st, so I've moved it ahead a little bit.
Is your contract subject to approval by the town? I don't see it on here.
Is
it subject to purchase the property?
No.
Okay.
There is definitely latitude from the seller on that, but
okay.
It's not a condition of the contract.
Okay.
They're very interested in selling. They're working.
Oh, Quebec, yeah, I bet. Okay. If there's no further comment, do we have a motion? Anyone? Okay.
No,
I'm going to put Mark on the spot. Judy?
Propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the application of L.E. Leiden Construction for amendments to Meadowview, a six-lot subdivision located off of Mitchell Road, be tabled to the regular January 1993 meeting of the planning board.
Any discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hands. Opposed? None. It's unanimous.
I'm just curious. Do I have to fill out another application or anything, Stat? No?
No.
Okay, so I'm on the next meeting agenda? Okay. Thank you.
But you do need to submit what we're talking about.
Right. I intended to submit it kind of earlier and kind of get reviewed by the town engineer at the time and town attorney.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to remark on the fact that Steve Parkhurst has sat through two hearings so that he could return and take his seat for consideration of the road standards. That is dedication above and beyond the call of duty.
I even told him he could go home.
Could be referred to something else, but we're wrong.
I'd like to give people the benefit of the doubt,
right,
at least to start with this, Francis.
I think he was sitting there looking for any typos or word changes in the upcoming article. However, I have a motion for the board.
Last order of business tonight under other business or old business is the road standards. Our ordinance amendments, the draft amendments, which we have worked on now for 2 years and perhaps 2 months, which for many of us seems like 2 years and 1 month too long. But we think we have them finally just the way we want them.
Would you like a motion for the board?
Yes, just let's go straight.
There is a time for discussion after the motion, but I will make a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the material submitted and the facts presented, the road standards revisions to the subdivision and zoning ordinance be recommended to the town council for adoption.
Any discussion? Judy Larkin?
Definitely have comments. Could I just go through here? Because Maureen has raised some questions, and I mean a page by page quickly. Is that okay? You snicker.
The word page by page is strikes fear in my heart now. That's go right ahead.
I would just suggest for the thousands of people that are watching this, that's an inside joke.
Okay. On the second page of your memo, Maureen, you were talking about the street trees and adding a bold statement about developing standards for street trees. I think that should be inserted. And you're commenting on cul-de-sacs with center islands versus ones without center islands. Is there some recommendation from you or staff that we should not be permitting cul-de-sacs without center islands? It wasn't clear to me.
No, there's no recommendation that you should not be. I can make a recommendation that they may not be in keeping with the supposed rural character of the town when you have a 50-foot wide circular paved area with nothing breaking it up. You're reducing the width of the paved roads, which at their maximum width were 24 feet wide, and yet you're still allowing a 50-foot wide paved area because it's on a cul-de-sac. Just one other comment I would like to make that I'd strongly recommend that any change that the board discusses as part of these amendments, just each one be adopted by consensus, so when you finally vote on your motion, I'm clear as to what final changes have to be made to the text. Mm-hmm. If that's so, my assumption is that everyone would like that note added about mm-hmm. the tree
yes.
species.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to keep track of what is to be amended, okay. So we'll add amended to the motion.
Well, on this comment you make about cul-de-sacs, the board, as this is proposed and also probably as the ordinance stands, we would have the wherewithal to certainly encourage a developer to reconfigure a cul-de-sac if we thought it was out of keeping with the character of the area.
That's correct.
Okay, and we could also revisit this at some later date if we felt it was very inappropriate.
That's true.
Okay. On the first page of the ordinance, proposed ordinance, I have no comments, nor on the second. The table looks great. On page 3, inadvertently, there was a footnote to that chart that we had eliminated that should be shown as being eliminated, footnote B after footnote A, which says see section 16-3-4A. There was another footnote that talked about the width of right-of-way for cul-de-sacs shorter than 300 feet.
Yes, and what I have done there, which is going to make it a little bit difficult for the person who's typing this in, is that I have actually not eliminated that statement, but moved it to a different location. Mm-hmm. It's now on page 2, near the bottom, and numbered number 2.
But we should eliminate it there, the footnote, since there's no chart, it's being footnoted too.
Right. What I did is under 2, I didn't underline it to show it to be new language, but you're right. Technically, the clearest way to do it would be to take it out in one section and mm-hmm. then add it in another, and I can do that.
Okay. Also, in that, almost midway down that page on B, side street and commercial driveway entrances. I wonder if this is an inadvertent change on about the fourth line down. It says feet above the finished grade surface to a point, and 2 was crossed out and 4.25.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Is that an error? Because it was not in any of our previous ones.
The town engineer and I kept trading back and forth, and I kept changing the wrong number. Originally, the number I had changed was 3.5.
Yes.
And I had changed that to 4.25, and he said, no, leave that at 3.5, but the number that should be changed to 4.25 is the 2.
Okay. Because that wasn't on any of our earlier drafts.
Right. I kept changing the wrong number.
Okay. On the next page, number 4, 3 under traveled way, At the last meeting, we discussed that for the arterial, the way to solve the sidewalk problem was probably to shift the right-of-way to accommodate a sidewalk esplanade on one side. Is there anything in this saying that the travelway shall be centered in its right-of-way that is an obvious conflict with that provision? I mean, we can waive it, but does it present any problems that we say one thing here and we're encouraging something else for arterials elsewhere? And does anyone understand what I'm saying?
Sure, yeah, I do. And
okay. Well, Steve, when we were at the workshop, we talked, Stephen Parker, we talked about to accommodate a sidewalk on the arterial, maybe we'd have one on one side and esplanades on both, but that would require shifting the travel way out of, it wouldn't be centered in the right-of-way. Which I don't think, Maureen, you said 77 is not really centered in its right-of-way along its length anyway.
No.
Is that correct? But it doesn't necessarily bother me. I just want to make sure it's not a real problem to have both approaches.
It is. It's conflicting. Is there something we could put in there, just even if it's except as addressed otherwise in this ordinance or as...
I don't know if
it is the sole right of the planning board to make that change or allow that or to waive that change.
No, actually there's one, isn't it the arterial that has the, that has an off-centered to allow for...
It can. It can if that's the...
I just wanted to raise it. I don't feel strongly about this. I saw that potential conflict and it might not matter.
Can I just clarify something in my own mind? We're talking about page 4, number 3, and the question is whether or not the traveled way has to be centered in the right-of-way.
Well, we say it shall be centered in its right-of-way.
But it also goes on to say that no waiver of this requirement shall be granted except in writing by the town manager or by the planning board. So we have the latitude to do that. So I guess I don't understand what the question is.
I guess because what we ended up in the workshop is actually proposing that any, whether it's changes to what the arterial that's there, or I guess future arterials if there could be, we would actually be recommending approach that is not centered. Not that we would allow it, we would really want them to have it off center, but it was just something I felt I had to raise.
Do you want to say, so generally be centered? Or do you know you want to do that?
I don't, you're an attorney, I would defer to staff.
You're right, there's definitely a conflict. I guess the reason I'm comfortable with it is that in a very recent project, for a good reason, an applicant proposed a road that wasn't quite centered in the right-of-way, and it was approved by the board as a normal procedure. If you were to state something in here that arterials can be moved out of the right-of-way, then you may be sending a signal that there's a whole host of reasons why that can happen, and I guess I would rather have an applicant to make a case, a good reason for moving it out of the center of the right-of-way, which this board and the town seems more amenable to do if there's a good reason.
Okay.
Isn't that something that also would show up on a site walk? I mean, if there's some significant trees or something that would make sense to shift it, then...
Oh, that's true, but I guess I'm always bothered when in the ordinance there are clearly two directions specified in the ordinance. You're supposed to center it, but you're supposed to have it off center. I mean...
Right.
I just like us to know that that's the case ahead of time.
What about just putting that next phrase, except as otherwise provided for in this ordinance? I mean, that to me at least takes away the conflict.
I would defer to staff or legal opinion. I just wanted to raise that, that's all.
Well, I think you've got a good point, and it rankles me too that it's not consistent. The other thing to consider is that any one of the road construction standards may be waived, and an applicant may determine that they would like another standard of the arterial section waived so that they could place sidewalks on both sides, in which case you wouldn't want them to move the arterial traveled way out of the center of the right-of-way.
Where does it say that anything can be waived?
It's near the end of the subdivision ordinance. Shouldn't say anything.
Well, I guess that was my question. Is there anything that cannot be waived?
You can't waive dead instance.
Authority of
well,
the
we already know that.
If you have the subdivision ordinance, it's page 31, section 16.3.5, and only things can be waived where the planning board finds that undue hardship practical difficulties or restriction upon imaginative and otherwise desirable design may result from strict compliance with this ordinance. It may waive one or more of the requirements of the ordinance in favor of proposed alternative upon a showing that, compared with strict compliance, the alternative will not create more hazardous traffic conditions or less sanitary sewage disposal conditions, will provide more varied and imaginative subdivision layout and design, will secure substantially the standards of the street design and construction required by this chapter, and will not have the effect of nullifying the intent and objectives of the comprehensive plan or this chapter.
Thank
so
you.
There's nothing that
Thank
is
you.
Limited.
I just have two more comments. On that same page, I wanted to ask Maureen what a teardrop cul-de-sac is.
I added that in at the request of Mr. Emery, and my understanding is it's the, and perhaps Mr. Wilcox may want to jump in and assist me at some point, but my understanding it's the kind of cul-de-sac where a standard cul-de-sac, when you drive down to the end, if there was an island, you would be looking at the island, where a teardrop cul-de-sac, you would go straight down and then start to make your turn around.
Oh.
It looks like a drop of water.
I think I know. Okay. On page number 5 of the memo, under monuments, I'm disappointed Tom Emery's not here because I think he could answer this. When we were talking about monumentation, the points of curvature, and I think Mr. Parker's brought up the idea of putting monuments at the property line intersections. Was the intent that all property line intersections would be marked on straight a ways too? And is that an onerous burden on the developer?
I'd understand.